Hey guys, how's it going today? Today we're going to be going into Tecumseh, the War Chief Tecumseh from the Battle of Tippecanoe and everything, which was the American overthrow of the Shawnee Indian tribe. We're just going to go ahead and get through this information. There's going to be quite a bit, so bear with me. You're going to find out about Tecumseh's brother, which his original name was like Lailawithika or something like that. But his name was changed after he died and then came back. Was shown a vision by the master of creation or something like that. Anyways, we're going to just go through all of this information. There's quite a bit here, so let's bear with me and let me get through the information. Okay, so we have, this is on history.com. There's your link. Okay, this picture is really going to crack you up. What kind of Indians are these? Freaking European Indians? This is crazy. It looks like a European on European war. Okay, now what we have is Shawnee Indian political leader and war chief Tecumseh, 1768 to 1813. Came of age amid the border warfare that ravaged the Ohio Valley in the late 18th century. He took part in a series of raids of Kentucky and Tennessee frontier settlements in the 1780s and emerged as a prominent chief by 1800. Tecumseh transformed his brother's religious following into a political movement. So this is when his brothers kind of mentioned, leading to the foundation of the Prophetstown settlement in 1808. Now, Prophetstown is because he was called the prophet. His brother was called the prophet. Let's see. Tecumseh transformed his brother's religious following into a political movement, leading to the foundation of the Prophetstown settlement in 1808. After Prophetstown was destroyed during the Battle of Tippecanoe, the Shawnee chief fought with pro-British forces in the War of 1812 until his death in the Battle of Thames, which we're going to go into. It's also known as the Battle of the Moravians. Born at Old Picou on the Mad River in western Ohio, Tecumseh grew to manhood amid the border warfare that ravaged the Ohio Valley during the last quarter of the 18th century. In 1774, his father, Pukeshinwa, was killed at the Battle of Point Pleasant, and in 1779, his mother, Methotesky, accompanied those Shawnees who migrated to Missouri. Raised by an older sister, Tecumseh had accompanied an older brother, Chicksika, on a series of raids against frontier settlements in Kentucky and Tennessee in the late 1780s. He did not participate in the defeat of General Josiah Harmer, 1790, but led a scouting party that monitored General Arthur St. Clair's advance, 1791, and fought at Fort Recovery in Fallen Timbers, 1794. Embittered by the Indian defeat, he did not attend the subsequent negotiations and refused to sign the Treaty of Greenville, 1795. By 1800, Tecumseh had emerged as a prominent war chief. He led a band of militant younger warriors and their families located at a village on the White River in east central Indiana. There in 1805, Lalawithica, one of Tecumseh's younger brothers, experienced a series of visions that transformed him into a prominent religious leader, taking the name Tenskwatawa, or the Open Door. The new Shawnee prophet began to preach nativistic revitalization that seemed to offer the Indians a religious deliverance from their problems. So, Lalawithica, his name became Tenskwatawa. And we're going to find out more about that here in a little bit. Tecumseh seemed reluctant to accept his brother's teachings until June 16, 1806, when the prophet accurately predicted an eclipse of the sun. The Indians from throughout the Midwest flocked to the Shawnee village at Greenville, Ohio. Tecumseh slowly transformed his brother's religious following into a political movement. Now, first off, I just want to go over something. The Shawnee village at Greenville, Ohio, right? Shawnee, just to kind of let you know how big of an area they had. Shawnee National Forest Preserve is in southern Illinois, and that is where it right by Little Egypt, that's where the Garden of the Gods is at. So the Shawnee owned all the way to Ohio and down into Illinois, which was pretty incredible. So we have, in 1808, Tecumseh and the prophet, his name's the prophet, moved their village to the juncture of Tippecanoe and Wabash Rivers. There, where the new settlement, Prophetstown, continued to attract Indians. After the loss of much Indian land at the Treaty of Fort Wayne, 1809, Tecumseh gradually eclipsed his brother as the primary leader of the movement. He traveled throughout the Midwest, urging tribes to form a political confederacy to prevent any further erosion of their lands. In November 1811, while Tecumseh was in the South attempting to recruit the Creeks into his Confederacy, U.S. forces marched against Prophetstown in the subsequent Battle of the Tippecanoe. They defeated the Prophet, burned the settlement, and destroyed the Indians' food supplies. After returning from the South, Tecumseh tried to rebuild his shattered Confederacy, but when the War of 1812 broke out, he withdrew to Michigan, where he assisted the British in the capture of Detroit and led pro-British Indians in subsequent actions in southern Michigan, or Manguagon, and northern Ohio, Fort Meigs. When William Henry Harrison invaded Upper Canada, Tecumseh reluctantly accompanied the British retreat. He was killed by American forces at the Battle of Thames on October 5th, 1813. Tecumseh's political leadership, oratory, humanitarianism, and personal bravery attracted the attention of friends and foes. He was much admired by both the British and the Americans. After his death, his body was never recovered. a considerable mythology developed about him, and he became an American folk hero. Here's all of the copyrighted shit. Okay, now we go to the next. When I look up Tecumseh's brother, the prophet, Tenskwatawa, also called Tenskwatawa and all these different spellings, or Lalawethika, January 1771 to November 1836, was a Native American religious and political leader of the Shawnee tribe. Known as the Prophet or the Shawnee Prophet, he was a brother of Tecumseh, leader of the Shawnee. Now, I just kind of wanted to go through how much stuff pops up about this guy. Okay, then. Now we're going to read the biography on Tenskwatawa. Okay, here's your link. Biography, yourdictionary.com. Okay, Tenskwatawa facts. Tenskwatawa, 1775 to 1836. Also known as the Prophet, was a Shawnee religious leader and reviver of traditional ways. With his brother Tecumseh, he worked to create an Indian confederacy to resist American encroachment on Indian lands. Tenskwatawa, known as Lalawethika in his youth, was one of a set of triplets born to Pukashinwa, a leader of the Kispokata division of the Shawnee tribe. His mother, Methataski, was of Creek descent. One of the triplets died in infancy, but Kumskaukau, the other triplet, survived. In addition to the two surviving triplets, the family also included three daughters and three sons. Tecumseh, who would later become a great leader of the Shawnee, was one of these sons. Lalawethika's childhood was not easy. Before he was born in October 1774, his father was killed in a battle against British soldiers at Point Pleasant. His mother, depressed at the loss of her husband and frightened by the impending American Revolution, left her children. It is believed that she either returned to her Creek relatives or went west. Her children were taken in by the Shawnee people. Lalawethika's older sister, who was already married, took her younger siblings into her household. Black Fish, a leading warrior, took an interest in the boys. However, Lalawethika's older brother Tecumseh was generally favored. Lalawethika was often left at home while the other boys and men went hunting or on small war excursions. R. Donald Edmonds writes in the Shawnee Prophet, "What little training as a warrior he received evidently was acquired from mimicking other small boys in the village. There is no evidence to suggest he ever possessed enough skill as a hunter to provide for either himself or his family. Insecure and abandoned, Lewitica compensated by boasting about how important and skilled he was. But his life did not match these stories. His childhood name, Lewitica, was a result of the boasting of this boasting. It means noisemaker or the rattle, a title of which he was not particularly proud. His misfortune only increased when he was blinded in his right eye during an accident while he was playing with a bow and some iron-tipped arrows. During adolescence, he began drinking liquor. His drinking habit fueled his bragging and made him even more unpopular among his tribesmen. In August 1794, Lewitica finally went with his two brothers, Tecumseh and Sawasikaw, to fight in a battle with the whites, who were led by Mad Anthony Wayne. Sawasikaw was killed. Tecumseh refused to participate in the treaty that followed the battle, although Lewitica is believed to have been there. In the next 10 years, Lewitica married and had several children, but was not skilled enough to provide for them. Discouraged, he drank more, which only made his wife angrier. During this time, he became friendly with Penagashia, a highly regarded medicine man and prophet. When Penagashawa died in 1804, Lewitica attempted to take his place and tried to cure others who were ill with diseases brought by the whites. Man, every article says that the whites brought the diseases. I don't care if I'm in an encyclopedia, if I'm online, if I'm in other books. I don't care. It all says that the whites brought the diseases. With little success, many members of the tribe were skeptical about his new career, doubting whether a man who had never lived a particularly holy life could ever be a healer or prophet. Then he gained a new name. So he was still Lewitica. Now he's going to gain a new name. Lewitica received his new name and his calling in the winter of 1804 to 1805, during a dark time for his tribe. Illness brought by white settlers ravaged the Shawnee, taking the lives of young children, older people, and even strong warriors. Lewitica had attempted to treat the sick people, but with little success. Sitting in his wigwam one cold afternoon, he took a burning twig from his fire, intending to light his pipe. Before he could do so, he dropped the twig and fell over, unconscious. His wife rushed out to find help. Lewitica's neighbors were skeptical about his illness. At first, they believed he had simply drunk too much and had passed out in a stupor. They examined him, found that he was not breathing, and decided he must have died. Preparations for his funeral were begun. Before the funeral could take place, however, Lewitica woke from his stupor and described what he had experienced, a vision given to him by the Master of Life. The Master of Life had sent two young men who carried his soul into the spirit world and showed him the past and the future. He saw the Shawnee paradise. He saw the promised land. He saw what? The Shawnee paradise. As well as a large lodge filled with fire where evildoers were wept as he described this vision, and swore to stop drinking and renounce his previous evil ways. Now he would no longer be known as a loudmouthed drunk. His name would be Tenskwatawa, or the open door, which referred to his new destiny as a holy man who would lead his people to paradise. Although a few of his neighbors were still skeptical, many others were convinced that he was sincere and his vision was true. He became a religious leader. Sorry about this freaking phone ringing in the background, guys, but that's life.
We are unavailable to take your call.
Tenskwatawa's visions continued. Other Shawnees, demoralized by the recent epidemics and invasions of the whites, saw him as a messiah. His religious message inspired them. He denounced the loss of traditional Shawnee values and spoke vehemently against the consumption of alcohol, describing his own drunkenness and its cure. So the cure was in the Master of Life. He also condemned violence, stealing, and sexual promiscuity. He urged people to treat elders with respect, perform traditional rituals, and return to traditional Shawnee ways. He also told his followers not to eat the meat of domestic animals or use white man's technology such as guns, flint and steel fire starters, or wear white man's clothing. According to Edmonds, the Master of Life told him that the whites grew from the scum of the great water when it was driven into the woods by a strong east wind. They are numerous, but I hate them. They are unjust. They have taken away your lands, which are not made for them. Shawnee people should not associate with whites in any manner, not even to shake hands, and any woman married to white men were to be brought back to the tribe. Tenskwatawa's teaching spread rapidly, not only among the Shawnee, but also among other tribes, to the great dismay of white missionaries. Despite his insistence on traditional values, Tenskwatawa was an outspoken critic of traditional shamanism and magic, and led witch hunts against people suspected of practicing these customs. Epidemics and misfortunes. I don't think I'm going to go into all of this. Once again, here's your link. I just thought it was neat that he's called the prophet. Also, I'm going to go into this as well. The War of 1812, the Battle of Thames, Moravian Town. So it's called Moravian Town by the British. The Battle of Thames, sometimes called the Battle of Moravian Town, occurred 5 October 1813 during the War of 1812. following the American naval victory under Captain Oliver H. Perry in the Battle of Lake Erie. So we have a Battle of Lake Erie. Tecumseh's objections. The Shawnee war chief Tecumseh contested the decision. His warriors were hesitant to retreat and were eager for combat against the despised Americans. Tecumseh soon questioned the willingness of the British to face the Americans with decisive action, fearing their ally would eventually betray the trust of the First Nations as they had in the past. The First Nations, indigenous peoples, First Nations. As they had in the past, Tecumseh held grave concerns at risk. No. Grave concerns that a weak retreat would leave the Aboriginal settlements west of Detroit at risk. So this American incursion needed to be confronted, not abandoned. Proctor managed to persuade the natives to follow his lead, promising he would make a stand before they made way to connect with Major General Vincent's forces. Proctor had roughly 900 men under his command, a sizable force he was not adept at wielding, as well as approximately 500 warriors under Tecumseh. The retreat began on 27th of September, 1813. Yeah, we don't care about that. Proctor's stand at Moraviantown. After a slow and disorderly withdrawal, Proctor took his stand near Moraviantown. The tired and dispirited British line broke early in the battle. They had a single 6-pounder artillery piece, but no ammunition. Still, they prepared for battle. The Aboriginals lay in the swamp to the British right, and Tecumseh rode by the British line of soldiers, shaking hands with each man before the battle took shape. So as you can see, man, Tecumseh just wanted peace. Harrison concentrated his men in a center column with the Kentucky-mounted riflemen riding hard and charging from the woods to discourage the British, who broke apart before they could deliver as a deadly volley and soon were firing only scattered fire. As the British surrendered, the mounted U.S. soldiers dismounted to confront the warriors in the swamp, meeting stiff resistance. The death of Tecumseh. As the battle in the swamp waged, Tecumseh was wounded and killed, as was the warrior chief Stehada, also known as Something and Roundhead, of the Wyandot people. Without their stout and capable leaders, the Aboriginal will to resist the very capable American soldiers was depleted, and retreat was more palatable. Proctor led the retreat after the battle. Some 246 British soldiers escaped and retreated to the head of Lake Ontario, leaving behind 606 killed or captured. An estimated 33 Aboriginals were killed, their bodies taken with the retreating survivors. American losses stood at 7 killed and 22 wounded. Harrison told U.S. Secretary told U.S. Secretary of War John Armstrong Jr. that all his casualties were a result of the Aboriginal warriors, not the British regulars. So the British didn't even help. They said that they was going to help. They freaking stood there like some cowards and let the fucking Indians be slaughtered. Or they didn't know how to fight, one or the other. Unable to sustain or build on his victory, Harrison and his men headed for Detroit. The Americans now in firm control of the Northwest frontier. Proctor would continue to command those who had fought with him, but his poor handling of the retreat and battle would be his undoing. The consequences of the Battle of Thames. To the First Nations, Proctor's actions confirmed their worst fears about the lack of resolution and commitment by their lifelong ally, King George III. Internally, their coalition would not survive the deaths of Tecumseh and Stiata, whose leadership, skill, and presence were critical to cohesion between the tribes. Harrison would soon sign peace agreements with various tribes in a move to divide and nullify Britain's chief ally. Most of the prisoners the Americans took ended up interned at an encampment in Sandusky, Ohio, suffering severe sickness in captivity. Relegated to menial commands for the rest of the war. Proctor's military career was soon over. In May 1814, he was charged with negligence and improper conduct. His court-martial, delayed due to operational reasons, was held in December. The judge chastened him for the conduct of his retreat and suspended Proctor from rank and pay for 6 months. He never held a senior command again. I don't know if you guys remember, in the beginning it had mentioned the Battle of Fallen Timbers, so I just decided I'll go into this a little bit as well. Actually, I'm just going to do this, and you guys can pause and go through it. I got a lot of other videos I want to cover today. The Battle of Fallen Timbers. Like I said, just feel free to pause. I'm gonna stop at every paragraph. That's it. Okay, well, hopefully we learned something. Hopefully this can help open some new doors. So, you guys have a good one. I'm gonna make some more.